I'm delighted to welcome Terri from the National Civil Rights Museum at the Lorraine Motel in Memphis, the USA. She is the president of the museum, and I just want to say welcome to the Best of Heritage 2020, Terri.
Thank you so much, Viv.
I'm hugely impressed with your work, and we have some questions that we would like to ask you.
And the first
Can you tell us something about your institution? Could you just describe it briefly for us?
Yes. Well, the National Civil Rights Museum resides within the Lorraine Motel, the historic Lorraine Motel, which was the assassination site of Dr. Martin Luther King in 1968 in Memphis, Tennessee. So the museum is actually built within portions of the historic motel, as well as built outside of the motel. And we house 24 permanent exhibits that walk people through the journey that African Americans have taken since they were stolen from Africa and brought to the United States. But we focus specifically on the civil rights era from 1954-55 until right around, I would say, 1970 or so. We highlight, obviously, 1968, which was the year that Dr. King was assassinated, but we walk people through all of the various campaigns that took place during that time that Dr. King was a part of.
It sounds amazing. I'm really interested to come see. Could you tell us now something about the history of the project that you won?
Yes. We actually received the National Medal for our 50th anniversary commemoration of the assassination of Dr. King. Every year on April 4th, we do a commemoration, but 2018 was the 50th anniversary, and your 50th is always considered the Jubilee year. It is a very special celebration, and 50ths only come around once. The other thing I would say about 50th anniversaries are those folks who are typically involved in whatever the original instance was. They're usually around for a 50th. They're not always around for a 75th. So we knew it was really going to be very important that we commemorate that tragic day in a way that we would emphasize Dr. King's legacy, as well as raise up those icons of the movement that actually participated with him, and those in particular who were here at the Lorraine Motel on that fateful day. It was a culmination commemoration, I would say. We began our commemoration activities a year prior, on April 4th, 2017, because that was the 50th anniversary of Dr. King's Beyond Vietnam speech. And that was when things kind of turned for him. He was not as popular as he had been in 1967. And because of that speech, there were so many people that actually shunned him because he was speaking out on the Vietnam War. He was also speaking out against capitalism, and folks thought that really wasn't what he should be doing. He should be focused on, you know, peaceful protest and you know, these legal rights, not necessarily these positions on policy around the military and what have you. And that was a troublesome year for Dr. King. And so we thought we would spend a year actually talking about his legacy. And we incorporated the faith community because Dr. King was a minister. We incorporated the scholarly community because he was definitely a scholar. And we incorporated young people because we have to remember Dr. King was 26 when he got involved in the movement and was 39 when he died. So we had a series of events throughout the year that engaged those communities. And then when we got to 2018, we included some, we did a project with the University of Memphis that looked at poverty rates over the course of 50 years, because when Dr. King came to Memphis, he came because of the sanitation workers who were striking because of wages and benefits and frankly, just an all-out lack of dignity for the work that they were doing. So he was very concerned about these issues of poverty. So we did a study looking at 50 years of poverty in Memphis, Tennessee, and found astoundingly that while there had been progress, African Americans in Memphis continue to make 50% of what whites do. So while there has been progress, the progress has always been without the ability for African Americans to actually match that what is earned by whites. We did that as a basis for a symposium that we hosted that included many thought leaders from around the country, which was hosted by NPR, former NPR commentator Michelle Norris. And that was a two-day symposium that we did in partnership with the University of Memphis, Cecil B. Humphreys School of Law. And then on the 4th, 2018, we had a day of commemoration that had many voices from the movement past, as well as those who were engaged in social justice work, human rights work, civil rights work today in the courtyard at the Lorraine Motel. From the balcony, we had speeches from those folks who actually were with Dr. King, Andrew Young, Reverend Jesse Jackson, there was speeches from the balcony of the Lorraine 50 years later. And at the moment that the shot rang out, which was 6:01 Central Time, we had bells ringing 39 times, one strike for every year that Dr. King lived. And that was actually a global effort. We had bells around the world ringing at what was, whatever time it was, 6:01, I'm sorry, Central Time, whatever the equivalent time was in throughout the world, we had bells ringing. And we received videos of monks ringing bells. We had bells here in Memphis that chimed. We had bells at the National Cathedral in Washington, D.C., and so many more. It was a very, very moving activity. And we ended the day with a more of a conversation between the icons and these new movement makers, talking about what had been done and what is being done now. And given what we are seeing around the world today, it was a very rich conversation of learning from young people, older people reflecting on what they had done in the mid-20th century movement, younger people talking about the challenges that they see today, but what they had learned from their elders. And it was a wonderful way to just remember who Dr. King was and what was truly important to him. And that was freedom, justice, equality, and equity.
Wow, that's a wonderful, rich program that you've organized there, Terri. It's incredible, yeah. Do you think there was a particular thing that really impressed the judges? It's such a rich program and international in scope as well.
Well, I think that part probably was a part of it. We really wanted to recognize the fact that Dr. King was not just a U.S. figure. He was a world figure. He was someone respected highly around the globe and received the Nobel Peace Prize for his work. So we wanted to make sure that everyone had an opportunity to participate in some way. I think the other thing was this idea of not just looking back, but connecting the past to the present and understanding that King would not have wanted us to be static in the moment. He would have wanted us to demonstrate some dynamism around these issues that seem to be so pervasive in our society. And I do think that we did a really, really good job of bridging the two. And saying to our audience, which was about 30,000, if I'm correct, that there's still so much work to do, and we should do it in the using some of the methods that King taught us, and understanding that King was not this mythical kumbaya figure. He was not just a dreamer. He was a man of action. He would want us to be moving forward on these issues of inequity and pushing forward for justice, truly for all.
Yes, I agree. Yes. I'm sure you had a number of difficulties to make the project come to fruition. Is there a particular thing that really troubled you? Or?
Well, you know, it's one of those things when we were pulling this together and we did not hire any additional staff. We have one person who was helping us as a project manager, and then we had some on-site help the day of April 4th, 2018. And I think our perspective was we knew all of the hiccups, some of which had to do with seating and what have you the day of, but everyone seemed to enjoy it. And as long as the audience didn't seem to perceive any issues, then we were good. We felt very, very comfortable with where we ended up. I mean, it's always difficult when you have as many moving parts and as many people and as many important people, some of which would be considered celebrities, that you are trying to coordinate. But it was a day of reverence. And people, I believe, understood that they were not here at this place for themselves, but truly to push forward the legacy of Dr. King. So it really all worked out very well.
Well, congratulations.
Thank you.
Well, Dr. King is an incredible scholar and a brilliant storyteller and able to make alliances across race and class and gender lines. Could you tell us a little bit about some alliances that you're particularly proud of that you've managed to make? You hinted with the young people and bringing together mm-hmm. traditional people mm-hmm. earlier on.
Well, you know, I would say that the museum is seen as holy ground almost, and we have the good fortune to work across racial lines, across ethnicities. In fact, the recent 150th birthday of Gandhi, the Indian community celebrated here at the National Civil Rights Museum and had a street that kind of borders the museum named Gandhi Way. So we cross ethnicities, we cross obviously gender and sexual orientation. It is a place that holds up this idea again of justice for all. And in fact, when you come into the museum, the first exhibit you walk into is an exhibit around the stolen people from Africa brought to the United States of America. And around the walls, we have the statement that says, we hold these truths to be self-evident that all men are created equal, recognizing that in that all, Africans, soon to be African Americans, were not considered a part of that all. So we really want to emphasize that when you walk into the National Civil Rights Museum, you are walking into history that is American history, not African American history, but American history. And I think that we have been able to do that very successfully. We do have quite a number of students that come through the museum, from those who are younger, I would say, older elementary school age, to those that are college students that come very, very regularly to the museum. But I think what I am most pleased with is a recent program that we instituted 3 years ago. It was in 2017 that we launched something called Unpacking Racism for Action, that is a 7-month dialogue series on implicit bias and systemic racism. And I am not going to say that I did not recognize that. Let me change that. What I'll say is, I knew then the pervasiveness of systemic racism was something that we needed to have a conversation about, because the issues that were going on in our community were not just issues of how you feel about me and how I feel about you, but of the systems that have been over 400 years in the making, oppressing people of color in particular, African Americans. And so this 7-month dialogue series really digs deep into those issues of implicit bias and systemic racism. And now, again, that we are in this time where race and racism and systemic racism has been so highlighted in our nation, it is a program that we are getting all sorts of interest in because of its content. So it's a timely program. It's a useful program. It's an effective program. It provides education, but it also, I believe, impacts people's hearts.
Yes, it certainly impacts my heart, Terri. I'm afraid we've run out of time, so I just want to say congratulations once again on a really important, globally important project, not just for your country, but globally. And well done for all the amazing work that you do, and that you're planning ahead, and you're going to do incredible things that will, again, positively impact on all of us to try to break those chains of oppression.
So, thank you so much.
Thank you, Terri.